big up the channel that I love called Podcast Cringe. I recommend you check it out. They do really good analysis and breakdowns of podcasts that we all know and love. What would you call them? Video essays or whatever they're called. So definitely check those kind of things out. I'm actually thinking of trying to do those things again. I used to do them before. Little clips. I'd make like 10-minute clips of like a topic and then kind of speak about it and insert clips and shit. It just takes so... It's just such a long effort to do. You have to collate the clips and record and edit it and shit. But I think I might give it a go and kind of, you know, diversify my content. But yeah, Podcast Cringe put out a really funny clip here called Bert Kreischer v. the Scientist, and it's really good because it demonstrates Bert's delusion. And in the end, like Podcast Cringe says, you end up feeling kind of sorry for him because it's only going to go one way, unfortunately. I'm not one of those people that likes to try and bet on how when Bert's going to fucking die, because I think that's fucking awful. But if he doesn't fix up, he's really going to be in big trouble because his brain is so broken when it comes to reasoning and shit. But let me play the video for you so you know what I'm talking about. This is Podcast Cringe. Let's go.
Let's be frank. I don't know you well enough to say this, but I'll say it anyway. You don't seem like somebody who can have just 2 a week. I think zero is going to be...
Let's talk logistics.
By the way, your fans probably hate me right now. They're like, why'd you bring this asshole on?
What's up, guys? Welcome back to another video. This is going to be a wild one. Bert Kreischer is officially out of control, and it's all on video for everyone to see. Latest episode of Two Dickheads in a Cave, Bert and Tom were joined by neuroscientist and podcaster Andrew Huberman. You may have seen his stuff on the Huberman Lab, which has been going for a couple of years, and he's also been on JRE 3 times, which is pretty much how he blew up. But I'll tell you what, if we needed concrete evidence that Bert Kreischer has officially lost his marbles, he handed it to us right here.
You do not want to become a parody of yourself. You do not want to be simply a meme of what people identified you as being. I think that's why you shake it up. That's why when Tom lost weight and started dressing real nice.
Big ups, Oz. Thanks for the stream. I'm stuck at work, so I'm just lurking in the background. Hello, chat.
Big up you, good robot. Appreciate you for hanging out, brother. Thank you for tuning in. Always great to have you. Enjoy your work and, you know, enjoy your day, brother. Thank you for hanging out with us, man. Hopefully we can entertain you from the background. From the background.
Has been a parody of himself for years. To hear him say that is just insane. He's clearly off with the fairies at this point. But here we have this celebrated neuroscientist on a podcast with Bert and Tom, and I should say that Tom handled it really well. He's actually a distant relative of Huberman, which is pretty crazy, and then you have Bert, who basically hijacked the whole podcast. I'd say a fair chunk of the episode was dedicated to Huberman low-key telling Bert that he should stop drinking completely, so I'm going to take you through the various exchanges between the two of them. Just quickly, as always, a massive push for us. Some of you have already, like I said, with Bert and Huberman, Bert's been on a diet for the last month and he's also given up drinking. So let's get into the background first and then I'll break it all down.
Check 1, 2. Yeah, we're back. Miggity, miggity, niggity, 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 niggery, niggity, nig, nig, nog, nog, nog. Mic check 1, 2. Pick up Uche. Niggity, 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 nig, nog. Mic check 1, 2. BLM, Wakanda. I can't breathe. Anyway. BLM, Wakanda. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. BLM, Wakanda. Big up Crash 984.
Why does it look like Bert died?
Yeah, it doesn't. Yeah, true, true. I didn't think about it, actually. Big up Crash. That's true. The artwork looks like Bert died, isn't it? Anytime I see a celebrity's picture on social and it's black and white or it's this sort of color, like this kind of looks like the thing that you'd see on like a wake, right? On like a leaflet or at a wake, right? That's what you'd see on the front of it. Anyway, so I was saying earlier when I was muted, I don't believe, do you guys believe that Bert has been sober for 30 days? I don't. It's impossible. supposedly he's been on ketosis for 30 days, not drinking, eating, you know, keto, being on a keto diet. I don't believe it in the slightest that he's been sober for 30 days. No way. No way. Not even a, no, no, impossible, impossible.
Down for you.
Just to bring everybody up to speed, about a month ago, Bert
and
had...
Also, you know why I think that? You know why I think that, by the way? Sorry to keep stopping it. You know why I think that? I think that is because we've seen what Bert looks like when he's not drinking. Do you remember that 1 year when he did Sober October and he actually did it? Because the other years, he lies. He does work out a bunch, but if you drink as much as he does, it doesn't matter. But I remember there was this 1 year that he did Sober October and he lost loads of weight. I think it might have been 2020 or 2019. Do you guys remember that one? There was this one particular Sober October that he did and he legitimately looked like he was in the best shape of his life. That, yeah, exactly. 2019, people are saying, yeah, Tim Okazi, exactly. So that's the time that I knew that he was sober, because the other times you could tell he's not because his face is still red, like full of fucking, you know, alcohol and whatever it may be. So yeah, like, no. Really? You think it's people, Natasha's saying it's not safe for him to go cold turkey? Really? Oh yeah, Uche and Natashki, you guys are right. Wasn't that what happened to Amy Winehouse? That's what they said about Amy Winehouse, isn't it, right? Amy Winehouse died because of that. She died because she tried to go cold turkey. Or she tried to... Right? Is that what they said, isn't it, I think? Fuck. Fuck. So, in a way, Bert is kind of like a prisoner of his own alcoholism. So if he wants to stop, he has to actually go and get help to stop first. Which he doesn't want to do, because if he has to get help to stop, it means admitting that he's got a problem, which he doesn't want to admit. Damn, son.
At a come to Jesus moment where he was like, I need to get healthier.
It was at the jazz festival.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because I was drinking. I mean, we just wake up, start drinking all day. And then
and you were touring a bunch.
I just got off tour.
The festival.
I was partying a lot.
And drinking then, a lot, eating like a lunatic.
My cardiologist was like, fucking keto.
Look at his face, bro. He looks like a fucking Saveloy. Bert's got this lie. I think people do this a lot when they don't want to face the realities of their life. Bert's got this lie that he does where he says he's got some sort of rash on his face. That's why he goes red. It's not because of alcohol. But I think it's a combination of the rash and the alcohol, because he always looks like this. He's always looks super red, but not like sunburn red, like red like you see the guys in your local pub and bar who look like they've been drinking a lot. And sometimes he looks so red, he reminds me of like homeless people who drink, because there's homeless people who don't drink, who just do drugs, but it's homeless people who like are alcoholics on the street, and they have this often inflamed redness to their faces. And Bert looks like that. He basically looks like one of those people, which is really awful and embarrassing, because Bert isn't homeless. Bert is a wealthy, well-regarded comedian and podcaster and shit. He has no business looking like a guy who lives on the street, but that's what he looks like in his face. You know what I mean? Like, fuck me, man. Yeah, that's Saveloy. This is a Saveloy. It's an English sausage. You get it, you get Saveloy, right? You get it in shop, Saveloy sausage. It's an English sausage. They usually steam it or they put it in the oven. I really like it because it's got a nice crispy skin. It's kind of spicy as well on the inside, but it's an amazing thing. It's one of my favorite sausages, to be fair. I love a good Saveloy. But he looks like one. That's what Bert looks like. A Saveloy. A big old Saveloy sausage. That's fucking Bert's face. Big Saveloy sausage. Let me get it. Where is it? There you go.
And I was like, really?
He goes, your cardiologist said that.
My cardiologist. He goes, there is so many benefits to being in ketosis. When you're in ketosis, you're not drinking. You can't drink.
Did I say that? One of his favorite sausages. Okay, big pause on that one. Actually, no pause. I love a good sausage.
Bert is deaf in big trouble. I've had uncles that were fine until they weren't. Sad reality of drinking. He reminds me of them.
Yeah, man. To be fair, I don't think it's sad. It's a slow death, but you know what you're doing to yourself. I don't really have any sympathy for people that get... that die because of alcoholism. It's like people that die because they smoke. Oopsie. Let's make a t-shirt for you then, I guess. GoFundMe. RIP, I guess. You did it yourself. I got no sympathy, really. I don't give a fuck. Really don't. It's not cool when you're trying to guess what age he dies, but I don't care. if you die from drinking yourself into a stupor. It's like Henry VIII, right? Dying of gluttony. You got no sympathy for me because you ate too much. Get fucked. Your family are probably better off without you, to be fair. I know it's harsh to say, but it's the truth. Let's be honest. If you're gonna risk your life and put your life in danger for fucking drinking and eating and shit, like, I like to party, right? Most of you guys know I like to party. And I know I like to party. But there comes a point when partying is only fun when there's balance. If I partied every single day, it wouldn't be fun. I've tried it. Trust me, it's not that fun. But when you have long periods of abstinence and you kind of, you know, you eat kind of clean, you don't go out as much, you sleep early, you wake up early, then when you then go out and party and have a good time, it's something to look forward to. The thing that I never understood with Bert, he's a multimillionaire, right? And he can do what he wants. And he also comes from a rich family anyway, so he's always been comfortable. There's no reason for him to drink as much as he does. Like, it makes more sense, people from my area of the world who drink because they want to numb themselves from the pain of everyday life, right? It's difficult to get jobs, to fucking hold down your family, your friends, your relatives. It's really hard. So I understand when people who come from bad situations or bad neighborhoods or whatever, or in a bad financial situations, drink, because it's the one thing that can legitimately, like, we can all fucking lie if we want to. Drinking does help sometimes when you're going through hard things. It does numb the pain. Obviously, you still got the pain in the next day. You still got your issues. But in the moment, drinking actually does help to kind of make you forget about your pain or to make it less painful. But when you're somebody that's got money and you come from privilege and you've got a job that allows you to make your own hours, why are you drinking like this? Why are you damaging yourself? Why are you putting yourself in a position where you're going to ruin your family's future? You're going to make them sad that you're not going to be around and shit. Why? I don't have any sympathy for it. Honestly, I don't. If you die, oh well. I might buy a t-shirt, whatever. I might sign your card. Cool. Sayonara, innit? Like, it is what it is. It's a valuable lesson for people to learn. But I've got no sympathy, got no empathy for it in the slightest. No. You know it's bad for you. Every day you piss in the morning and you see that fucking super inflamed tortoise shell of a fucking stomach that is super hard, full of fucking gas and liquid and shit, you know you're making the wrong decision. Every time you look yourself in the mirror and you see your face all puffy and inflamed, like you got stung by all the bees in the world, like you got punched in both fucking eyes, you know it's the wrong thing to do, but you keep doing it.
Can if you were going to break it, but I don't want to break it. So I've been in ketosis for a month and I've been not drinking for a month, like since the jazz festival.
Okay, so anyone who's been following Bert for a while now knows that he's got an alcohol problem. It's gotten really bad over the...
That's the thing to Uche. I don't think he's got an addiction. This is the thing. I'm going to die on this shitty hot take. I'm really going to die on this shitty hot take. But I don't think Bert is addicted to alcohol. I really don't. I just think he loves to have a good time. I just think he doesn't know what what's that thing called? He has no concept of delayed gratification. It doesn't exist in his brain. He's just all about treats and fun and party and whatnot. I don't think he's an alcoholic. Honestly, it's a hot take and it's really wrong. I know most of you guys won't agree, but I honestly don't think he's an alcoholic. I just think he doesn't know how to not have fun, and having fun for him is drinking. He doesn't, you know what I mean? Like he's always a treats guy. If he loved chocolates, he'd be eating chocolate every single fucking day. But I don't think he's an addict. You know, if that makes sense to me. I don't know if that makes sense or am I looking at it the wrong way, but I don't know.
The last few years, and I think it's definitely affecting his output. His podcasts are shit. His stand-up is old and boring. Basically the same stories recycled over and over again.
AZ, did you see Bobby Lee take a dig at Bert and Tom on today's episode of Theo's podcast? The way Bobby described Bert without actually saying his name was spot on. Timestamp starts at 9:20.
Yeah. I saw that. I'll play that after, actually. I saw that. I wasn't sure if he was joking or if he was being serious. I don't know. I think it was a joke. I don't know what you guys thought. But it did sound a bit weird how he said it. I really wanted fucking Theo to ask him if Brian Callen or Brendan sent in a clip or something. I really wanted him to ask that. But obviously they didn't. But I really wanted to find it out. But that didn't happen. But yeah, I did see that. It was fucking hilarious. I fucking saw that. Of course I did. I find it funny also that Bobby Lee fucks as much. Like, he's, because he was talking about the dates he's been on. Like, it seems like Bobby Lee's not sure of options. Bobby Lee must have some game behind the scenes. Like, he kind of acts a bit goofy and shy in front of camera, but he must actually, I should have known, innit? He's always really charming when he goes on those TV shows. The women always like him. But Bobby Lee's got options, man. It seems like he's been on the tear. He's been out living his life since Kalila left, or since they broke up. He's been enjoying himself, Bobby Lee. So big up Bobby Lee, man. He's been enjoying himself. He's not, you know what I mean? Bobby's got options out there. He's not struggling.
So going sober for a month is...
Oh, also, before I continue, I wonder who's going to be with Kalila now. Kalila. Because Kalila can't be with a normal guy now, right? She's already tasted the good life with being with a podcaster. I don't see her, hooking up with some normal dude.
Is Ooch single asking for my friend Oz?
Ask her yourself, Hi-Dev. She's in the chat. Ask her yourself. Ask Uche yourself in the chat. Actually, you know what? I'm going to enforce a rule here. After the whole Russell Brand nonsense and stuff, there's going to be no frolicking and no fucking exchanging of saliva or other bodily fluids within my chat, okay? If you want to do that stuff, please do it somewhere else, okay? But no exchanging of bodily fluids in my chat, okay? I'm not having that. But yeah, I want to see if Kalila's going to end up with another comedian or podcast. I imagine she will do, but I wonder which one it will be. And most likely, whoever she ends up with is probably one of the guys that has been trying to hit on her while she was with Bobby. Or, because I think Bobby said, what did Bobby say? Didn't Bobby say there was some guy tried to ask Bobby for Kalila's number when they broke up or something? Some comedian. And people were hypothesizing, I think, on the Tiger Belly forums or Reddit, sorry, that it might have been Joy Coy. Imagine that. Imagine your friend asking you for your friend's... Imagine that. Can you imagine? I would punch you in the face, bro. Can you imagine? Your friend asking you for your ex-girlfriend's number, like, what? Do you want to die, brother? Joy Coy. Joy Coy.
Actually a really good idea.
Yeah, exactly, Tim Okazi. Aye, bro, your ex is hot. Let me hit her up. Your ex is hot. Can I smash?
But here's the thing. Bert doesn't recognize that he has a problem. And I'll talk more about that in a little bit because it's super important if you want to understand why Bert is such a lost cause. For now, though, Huberman tries to educate Bert on alcohol, and it seemed like it was starting to sink in.
Alcohol's a weird fucking word.
Z, I always thought Joy Coy was into guys. He kind of is, probably, isn't it? Wasn't his ex fucking Chelsea Handler? She's very guy-looking, isn't it? She's not the most feminine of ladies. So maybe he kind of is into dudes. You know what I mean? He likes his women mean. He likes his women mean and kind of Aryan race lookingly. You know what I mean? Because Chelsea Handler kind of looks like... Oh, Chelsea Handler looks like that woman in... what's the fucking Star Wars TV show? Andor, that's it, Andor. There's a woman in Andor and Chelsea Handler looks like it. Andor TV show, right? She looks like that woman in Andor, the evil one that kind of plays like she's like a Nazi officer. Is that her there? Is that her? Deidre, is that her? Chelsea Handler kind of looks like this woman. Yeah, this lady from Andor. She looks like her. Denise Goff, let's do Andor. So maybe Chelsea, you know, she's kind of got that kind of evil, you know, look about her in the face. Don't get me wrong, I'm just saying because she's white and blonde, but you get what I mean, isn't it, right? That's Chelsea Handler. That's what Joy Coy is into. She's kind of manly looking here as well, isn't it? So yeah, that is definitely Chelsea Handler. There she is. Good old Chelsea Handler. Good old... Anyway, let's get back to Bert. What are we doing? Let's get back to Bert.
It's overused. It's like saying... True.
They should now say alcohol use disorder is another one. Listen, it's different things for different people. Some people, it's one or two at the end of the day, and they, quote unquote, need that drink. Other people, they have just one drink or even half a drink, but it dramatically changes their personality.
Yeah, those are
other
bad
people,
ones.
They drink to blackout drunk.
Yep.
Other people, they're like the Don Draper character in Mad Men. They can drink, 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 and the next morning there they are looking, you know, all right angles and working, and you're like, whoa, you know, like how they do that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. A lot of genetic variation in terms of how quickly people metabolize alcohol, how thoroughly they metabolize alcohol. I'm not going to do the whole podcast episode on alcohol because I did that for my podcast, but
Do you drink?
It is poison, mm-hmm. right? Let's just be honest. It makes you feel the way it does because it is poison.
Yeah, this is crazy. A lot of people don't realize
that. I love how they had that, I forgot his name. Fuck, jazz musician. I don't know why he was there, to be honest, because he hardly said
anything. Makes you feel the way it does because it is poison.
Yeah.
Right, what's his name? They had him on there and he hardly spoke.
It is poison.
He hardly spoke. I forgot his name. Famous jazz musician. And they didn't know he's fucking... He's super religious too, if I'm not mistaken. That's why he doesn't drink. But they didn't even... You know what I mean? That's the thing about these comedians, right? They get around actually talented people, artists and stuff, where it would make for an interesting conversation. And they don't even share the space, the room, the conversation. It's all about them. Comedians must be the most infuriating people to talk to in real life. Maybe second only to podcasters, really, to be fair. Maybe. In terms of being so self-absorbed, where it's only about you. Imagine being in a room with, like, you know, with Robert Glasper on the podcast, and you're just taking up all the time. You're not even asking about how he produces albums, how he does, how he puts together arrangements and whatever. No, you're just all about you and fucking stand up and your fucking addictions, right? Or your denials of your addictions or your delusions. Imagine. God almighty, man.
Right. Let's just be honest. It makes you feel the way it does because it is poison.
Yeah, this is crazy. A lot of people don't realize this. Alcohol is fucking poison. Your body literally treats it as a toxin, which it is. And sure, there's nothing wrong with drinking in moderation, blah, blah, blah. You know the story. And so for Bert, he's getting on board and he isn't really pushing back at this stage. But the reality is about to set in for him because Huberman senses that Bert doesn't realize just how bad his drinking is. And he basically lays it out for him with some hard truths.
Here's the deal. Zero alcohol is better for you than any alcohol, but the cutoff, if you're not an alcoholic or somebody prone to alcohol use disorder, etc., and you're of age, probably two drinks per week should be the upper ceiling. Beyond which,
is that a guy with
there are a lot of data now out of the UK brain.
I love how Bert can't process the idea of having two drinks a week. Legitimately can't process that. He thinks it's impossible. Can you understand how crazy that is? That's mad. Like, there are times, right, in my life where I bumped into we went to a festival one time, me and my friend, and we bumped into this guy on the train who started talking to us about alcohol and, you know, alcoholism and shit, which when we were drinking and fucking high, and he showed us his fucking chip, right, of sobriety and shit. And he was saying basically he noticed it was an issue. He knows he had an issue when he started drinking. What did he say to us again? Oh, that's it. When he started having a bottle of wine for lunch and another bottle of wine for dinner. And then he noticed there was an issue when his wife had to then go start buying her own bottles because he'd finished them all. Like, he didn't realize he was finishing them all. Like, because he basically was saying, like, he was working really hard, waking up early in the morning to travel to work, coming back late at night. But in between, he'd be going to meetings, like in restaurants and shit. He'd order wine. He'd go and have drinks after work with his colleagues, order wine. He'd come back home and make some dinner, or order something and have a whole bottle of wine. And he didn't realize it was a fucking issue until his wife had to start buying her own bottles of wine and having them separately. So he wouldn't take his. And I think that's what happens with drinking, isn't it? You don't realize how much you actually drink until you stop drinking. Like, I've had plenty of occasions in my life where, you know, I've gone out and shit and not drunk in anything. And sometimes you go out and you drink the whole bar. But the idea of not drinking, of drinking maybe twice in a week, is easy. It's not that difficult at all, especially if you don't really have a big social life or you don't really hang out in bars and whatever. It's not that hard to only drink two drinks a week. It's not really that difficult, to be honest, if you want to. It's just astonishing that Bert can't even fathom that. It doesn't even knock on his head. Like, why would you start drinking and then stop. It's like, in his head, it's like, if you have one burger, you might as well have five. That is fucking insane, bro. That's the saddest bit about me for him in this. It's that laugh. Two drinks. It's like, come on, brother.
Bank that's showing that, you know, the more you drink, for every additional drink you have per week, a little bit more brain atrophy, shrinking of the brain and loss of neurons.
My brain is firing hot. Yeah, I notice my flow of speaking is going on stage. My brain is working so much better.
This is so good. You're such a vigorous guy. Like you have so much vigor. Word that comes to mind when I think of you, Kreischer, is not alcohol. It is robust. There's like this robustness to you, right?
So there was a moment there where Bert was like, what the fuck? Two drinks per week? Yeah, that ain't happening. And then Huberman starts to pump him up, calling him robust. Whatever the fuck that means. Pretty sure that's not scientific. But then Huberman finally gets to the point here and, well, Bert isn't exactly on board.
I have a hidden agenda, which is my hope is that I saw you post on social media, you're not going to have another drink until you hit 230,
yeah.
230 pounds. I think you should cut it out for good and watch your creative work and everything else skyrocket. Yeah. And I'm sure there are a bunch of fans that are like, oh my God, does that mean I can't drink while listening to Kreischer? No, we're not talking about them. We're talking about you.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm not here as a, you know, addiction counselor. I don't tell people what to do, yeah. Right? I'm not a physician. I don't prescribe anything. I'm a professor. I profess a lot of things, but I profess that if you were to stay off alcohol completely, not only are you going to live a lot longer, but that robustness is going to be exponentially greater. It'd also be fun to just do comedy and live life through that lens. There's so much more to discover. And no,
it's the fact that he has to be told this at his age, at this stage of his life. That's ridiculous. He has access to all the best physicians, doctors, you know, nutritionists and whatever at his fingertips. He's one of his best friends and colleagues at work is fucking Dr. Drew. But yet he has to be reminded of this stuff constantly and it still doesn't get through in his head. That's why I don't have sympathy for the guy sometimes. That's why I don't have sympathy for it. He just doesn't listen. Zach, he doesn't listen, doesn't care. How often have we heard this conversation around Bert? I feel like I've heard this stuff around Bert at least four times a year. You hear somebody having this come to Jesus talk with him or him doing the whole like, oh my God, I feel so much better now. It's like, bro, either get it together or don't, but leave us alone, please.
Oh, I'm not telling you have to quit smoking weed. Let's be frank. I don't know you well enough to say this, but I'll say it anyway. You don't seem like somebody who can have just two a week. I think zero is going to be.
Let's talk logistics.
By the way, your fans probably hate me right now. They're like, why'd you bring this asshole on?
There's no one who has two drinks a week. There's not.
There's plenty.
If you're that person, you're lying to yourself. No one goes, well, that one whiskey was great. I'll have another one Thursday. Fuck off.
I saw Tom have one drink the other
night. Oh, he's dead inside.
He always says this.
Like, I don't even think you finished your drink.
I don't think so either.
I don't think you finished.
Man, I'm so...
That's so stupid because I've done that plenty of times. Don't get me wrong. One of the main tricks of it or issues of it is like I'm kind of fortunate in that I never really grew up in a household where people drank, mostly because we were super religious, right? I grew up in a super strict Christian conservative household where that shit just wasn't allowed. My mom and dad would never fucking allow that. So there was no drinking alcohol. So I never had it. By the time I did have my first sip of alcohol, I must have been like 18 or 19 or something, right? It came super late. And by that time, it wasn't really a big deal. I'd only do it when I'm partying. And then after that, it didn't matter. But then when I moved out, I then realized that I wasn't buying drinks at home. You know how people sometimes will go to the shop and buy like, a whole crate of beer or something to have in the fridge so you can drink something, you know, for your dinner or whatever. I don't have that. I just have water and cold brews in my fridge or fucking orange juices. That's all I have, right? I don't have anything else. So when I want to buy alcohol, I'll go outside and get it. And usually if I want to get it, I might get a bottle of beer or I might get a little mixer thing or like these little magnums that we have here in the UK, which are amazing. These little fucking tonic drinks that are just full of sugar, right? But I fucking love them. I might buy one of those and I'll buy one and then that's it and then leave it unless I'm actually going to party that day for the most part. That's it. Like, so for him to suggest that there's no one out there that drinks two times a week is insane. There's many people that do that. Many people. Because drinking isn't like, it's not an escape from reality. It's a nice like way to end the week. I've got friends like that who will purposely, you know, because I worked in startups, and loads of startups will have a fridge where they put beers in. And usually at the end of the week on a Friday, someone will go to the fridge, pull out the beers and leave them on the tables for everyone that's still working. And then just drink one on the Friday before you leave your shift. Then close your laptop and then go home. You're not going to the bar afterwards with your friends. You just have that one drink to kind of symbolize it's the end of the week and now you're going away. People do that all the time. So him thinking that people only drink to get drunk, that might be an alcoholic thing, to be fair. I'm maybe coming around to it now. Maybe I'm coming around to it. In his head, the only way to drink is to get drunk or get tipsy. That might be his alcoholism talking, right? Maybe I'm coming around to it. Maybe my hot take was wrong. Because who else says that? Who else says you can only drink to get drunk? You only drink to get drunk. Like,
I'm glad someone who is actually qualified sat down with Bert and told it to him straight. I doubt anyone's really told it to him like that before, because he surrounds himself with yes men, and his wife is probably just happy that he's bringing in the cash every month so she doesn't grill him about it. You know, it could unsettle the beast. And look, I don't know how many of you listening to this right now know someone who is an alcoholic. Maybe it's you. But for me, I've had two best friends who were alcoholics, and by far the biggest barrier to getting sober and helping themselves is just acknowledging that they have an actual problem. And that's exactly...
Oh, okay. Now I get it. Now I'm understanding. Now I'm understanding. So I take back my hot take. I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm talking out of my ass. So I guess this delusion thing that Bert has is common to alcoholics. All alcoholics are delusional and they refuse to acknowledge that they have a problem, which is the first step to them getting help, but they don't get it. Now I understand. This all makes sense. That's why he always lies about how much he drinks, right? He always lies about, I only had one. I've been sober the whole week. Actually, I had a drink on Friday. I didn't have a drink in the morning. I only drink in the evening. He's always lying, right? He's always kind of obfuscating how much he actually had. Oh, now I get it. I feel like an idiot. I was like, he's not drunk. He's not an alcoholic. He's just dumb. He's just delusional. I was like, no, that is what an alcoholic is. It's all those things in one. That must be the hardest addiction to break then, isn't it? Even more, because I think alcohol must be the hardest addiction to break, up there with cigarettes. Because with Class A drugs, you have to get them first and they're expensive. It doesn't matter if you're doing coke, MDMA, ketamine, LSD, GHB. They're hard to attain. They're illegal, obviously, and they're sometimes expensive. But cigarettes and alcohol are super affordable for most people. So it must be the hardest things to break, those two addictions, cigarettes and alcohol. Fuck, bro. I'm so lucky, honestly. I'm so fortunate I never had both of them, because I already have my issues. I already have my fucking things that I suffer from. So I can't imagine how I'd be if I was addicted to cigarettes and alcohol. I'd be fucked. Damn, son. Big up, Uche.
Alcohol/substance use disorder is the only disease a doctor can say that you have, and you just genuinely don't believe them.
Ah, you see? There we go. Thank you, Uche. Big up, Uche. I feel so redacted. I actually feel, this is what I think is happening here. Every time I cover Brendan and I do this stream, it's not me, obviously, because I'm perfect. I think when I keep doing these streams, my brain sort of like breaks. So my ability to like comprehend things and understand where people are coming from, it kind of disappears. So I thank the chat and I thank Uche for always keeping me on the straight and narrow and helping me to see things, because I feel like an idiot. Oh, he's not an alcoholic. He doesn't have an addiction. He's just fucking lazy. He should man up. It's actually, his brain is broken. He's actually got something wrong here. Do you know what I mean? It's a legit disease. As Uche said, it's a legit disease. And he doesn't even want to acknowledge it. Fuck, man. I fucking got it. Anyway, let's play it. Big up the fucking podcast cringe. You're an absolute G for clarifying that. Let's go back again.
Who is an alcoholic? Maybe it's you. But for me, I've had two best friends who were alcoholics. And by far the biggest barrier to getting sober and helping themselves is just acknowledging that they have an actual problem. And that's exactly what I'm seeing here from Bert. Here's how it goes. They'll stop drinking for a couple of weeks or even a month like Bert, but they're only able to do it because they know that it's not permanent. They know they'll have a drink again soon. That's how they get through that short period of time without a drink. Some of you will know exactly what I'm talking about. The hardest part for addicts to get over is the fact that they can never drink again. That's very different to stopping for a few weeks. And alcohol's everywhere. You can't get away from it. So it's the idea of not being able to drink socially or during the festive season that makes it so hard for alcoholics to get sober. They think they can drink in moderation and slow it down, but the reality is it's either zero or 100. That's what alcoholism is.
That explains so fucking much. If you watch Bert's content, you'll know he gets really triggered by people talking about sobriety. He gets really triggered, like more than regular person would. It kind of makes him pissed off. And at first I used to think, is it because he's getting triggered because he's going to lose a part of himself? Because part of his identity is being the t-shirt off guy, tops off, party guy, beer pong, bloody blah, blah, blah. No, it's actually because the idea of sobriety is the idea that he has to quit drinking, the one thing that he loves and enjoys. And then I also found out why, from this explanation, why Bert seems to love Sober October so much. Because Sober October gives him a chance. Oh my God, this is so clear. Bert doesn't like Sober October because it gets him fit and in good, healthy condition, or gets him looking in the best shape that he's ever looked in his life. Bert likes Sober October, or most alcoholics like to have a period of sobriety, because it gives them something to look forward to at the end. It's like a treat. And one thing we know about Bert, Bert loves treats. He loves rewarding himself. He loves rewarding himself. He loves a little party for himself. He loves patting himself on the back. And what better way to pat yourself on the back than going sober for 30 days? Oh, this is so illuminating. My God. Wow. But you know what's scary about this, bro? Not to be, because I love her, right? I love Leanne Kreischer. She seems like an absolute angel. And of all the comedian wives and girlfriends that exist, she's definitely up there. Bert Kreischer's wife and Bill Burr's wife. But Leanne Kreischer kind of enables him a little bit, doesn't she? I know she doesn't like that he drinks, but she also doesn't really put her foot down.
Here's the thing, is like, all the stuff, doesn't compare to the sparkle you get after like a cold fucking beer where it just goes, shh, it's all gonna be okay. You should dance,
yeah, man. But you know
in like the back, that feeling.
But sure. You know in the back of your mind that Jesus that shh, it doesn't mean it's all gonna be okay. It's lying to you.
I don't need the prostitute it's all gonna be okay. To tell me this is a business transaction. Say that you love me. I don't give a fuck how I get told I love you. Just say it in my ear. I don't care if you mean it.
So you'll
just
pay fucking for the delusion.
That's what drinking is.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The delusion is so awesome.
But the payment is.
The delusion is so awesome. Have you heard anything sadder in your life? A guy who has everything, a guy who could be living the best life possible, is choosing to live this way, where he's living in a delusion, which is robbing him of life. Valuable time with his family and friends. Like, can you imagine the amount of times Bert's woken up hungover in his life? The amount of time he's wasted not being with his kids and shit on the road and stuff. And he's another one. He's like Brendan. He likes to tour to stay away from his family. He can pretend now, but because they maybe the girls are grown now, so it's different. But he didn't like to stay at home. He liked to always be on the road. Fuck Bert, bro. Yo, big up Doid. Big up, big up, big up.
It's through your biology, through your
biology,
liver.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We're all going to get die one day.
Yeah, man, that's crazy. Anyone who knows an alcoholic will immediately be nodding their head after seeing that conversation. It's the same shit. And I honestly feel for Bert. He really is delusional. I don't think he'll take it seriously and stop for good. And he's kind of lucky in a way that he's so rich. For a lot of alcoholics, they struggle to make ends meet, and that just fuels their addiction and causes more problems at home. So for Bert, it's definitely not as bad as it could be if he had to work a regular job or whatever.
There's a part of me that I grew up with that, from 22 to here. That
Yo,
when-
imagine, oh, bro, I feel so bad for saying that I don't care if he dies from alcohol now, from alcohol abuse. I feel so terrible for saying that now. Because imagine how horrible it must be if you're a regular person and you're an alcoholic. As the podcast Cringe says, right? You're an alcoholic. It then puts you in bad situations or bad positions where you might get fired. You know, you might lose friends. Your family sort of like abandons you, which then makes you more miserable. So then you go to drink more to kind of numb the pain. And so the cycle continues. And you just get in the eternal loop of misery and suffering. And you try and medicate that by just drinking yourself silly. Okay. Now I understand a little bit why people are being so concerned about him online. Because I think a lot of people have alcohol, you know, have had somebody in their family, in their close group of friends, or somebody they know loosely suffer from this. I think so. I think it's very common. I think that's why a lot of people speak about it and they kind of are concerned. Maybe what I see as like sinister, people guessing when he's going to die, is actually people being concerned and wanting him to like get right. Damn it, man. My hot takes are so shit. I've got the worst track record for hot takes. So whatever, let's play.
When I go, who wants a drink? And that feeling, that energy, I don't ever want to lose that. It's like a first kiss. It's so fun that you're like, what's funny is I'm trying to build intrinsic value in myself by watching him sober last night and going, you're like,
Jared Mederick, concerned I'd dump him in a body given the opportunity. Just roll him down the hill. He'll keep rolling.
From alcohol.
No,
rolling. Big up Fred Durst.
So I was sober.
Oh, okay.
I was watching him sober and I went, man, this is fucking still awesome and I don't need alcohol. Right now it's a lot of growing things, but like I'm definitely drinking on my cruise. I want to drink at Red Rocks. Like there's times I want to have a cold beer. I want to be a part of the, I want to be back in the Matrix, you know, like fucking feel myself plug in and taste the steak. Like I know that sober, it's more valuable and you feel better the next day, but there's a fucking sparkle this sobriety doesn't give you sometimes. I think a guy like you, you're so fucking smart, you can't fuck with anything but the truth. I like the lie.
So yeah, exactly what I was saying. He refuses to acknowledge that he's got a drinking problem and that he'll never be able to drink again. That's definitely the biggest hurdle. And
it must be kind of hard for him to be that delusional, though, because he has to put these screens up around his life, isn't it? Because Tom Segura got his life together. Even though Tom has never really been a big drinker, he's lost loads of weight and got really healthy. And then who's the other guy? The comedian with the white hair. He was always known for drinking. He's got sober. He looks incredible now, actually, right? His hair looks shiny now. He's all white and stuff. So it must be hard for Bert to like handle it. Everyone around him's kind of fixing up and he's the only one. Yeah, run white. That's it. Run white. Yeah, exactly. Henry Poet. If he dies, he dies. I take it back, man. I feel bad now. I feel bad for saying that. I feel like such a jackass, as you guys say in America. I feel like a jackass for saying that, man. Fuck. Don't get me wrong. He's not my friend. I don't know him. But, you know, I'm not as callous anymore because I understand now it's an addiction and it actually is a fucking disease and it actually is kind of serious, you know? And it is also super sad. Anyway, that's all of it. I'm not watching the end of it. Watch it. Check it out. Subscribe to my guy, Podcast Cringe, please. Amazing channel. He does really good in-depth little analysis on pods and shit. And he's one of my favorites. So check out Podcast Cringe. Subscribe to his channel. Don't delay. Don't be an idiot. Subscribe to Podcast Cringe. Subscribe to Podcast Cringe.